This presentation is an expanded version of the one I did in Deliberative Summer School last February, but with some changes, some adjustments after suggestions and discussions I have had these last months here in the center. It would take around 30 minutes. As some of you know, this is a work in progress. It's part of my PhD research, which aims to understand the constraints on public deliberation about mining in Minas Gerais state, where I come from in Brazil. And this presentation is divided into 5 steps. I will give a brief description of the context, then I will discuss the 4 issues in which I consider the presence of factors that constrain the public deliberation about mining in the civil society, observing the absence of unity between actors in the press, observing bargaining relationship between news media and mining companies, in 3 institutions of the State Environmental Council, in the Public Prosecutor's Office, and in Legislative Assembly. And I finish with the time control, time dispute dimension, observing 4 time dimensions. Minas Gerais State observed a huge increase in mine activities starting from around 2003, mainly from Chinese demand. Iron ore was the main commodity exported in the country between 2009 and 2013, for example. And mining expansion also was connected to a lot of environmental conflicts. Most of the mines expanded or opened are in areas close to aquifers or are close to urban areas or impact rural communities, some with traditional livelihoods. So my question is why, although a lot of these conflicts exist, although they are strong and they cause harm to a lot of people, and although some civil society actors try to make them visible, speaking about the risks involved, why these problems were not enough to enhance a public deliberation about mining? In some sense, only after 2 huge tailing dams ruptures, 2 disasters with more than 200 deaths in 2015 and 2019, the press, the Legislative Assembly, and other political actors joining together in some kind of public reflexivity about some of the problems involved with the activity. Then with large exposure on the news media, with the discussion of laws that restrain the activity and so on. So my focus is not to discuss what happened after these disasters, although they are important and there is good research being done about them, but to understand what happened before and to help in this process. I'm working with in deep interviews with actors involved with the question, environmentalists, affected people, environmental bureaucracy workers, mining workers, journalists, politicians. These 4 dimensions that I represent here are based on the analysis of 17 interviews conducted last year with these actors, but also is connected to other 25 interviews I did in my master's research, and which was focused on one of these environmental conflicts involving mine activity. So let's discuss the 4 issues in which the constraints of the public debate are manifested. The first point is the civil society, and the constraint is the presence of a disconnected civil society or fragmented civil society. I doubt how to label this. So my question is, if pluralism is not always enough, the conflict of different perspectives between civil society actors can be powerful for public debate, but in a public sphere fragmented by a diversity of other social agendas, in a scenario of a diverse structure of political opportunities, the inability to build a common master frame about mining seems to hinder the projection of the problems produced by the mining industry and its allies, and to point out solutions. I can say there were and there are significant actions of environmental civil society trying to give visibility to human rights violations and environmental losses connected to mine expansion. It's possible to observe social media activism, demonstrations, judicial actions to stop mining expansions, etc. And in some cases, all these things strongly contributed to avoid or postpone some actions planned by mining companies and the state. But, and I need to be very careful here, it seems that these environmental civil society groups act in a way that sometimes they are not able to articulate a common master frame about the mining problem. There are different views about what are these mining problems and how to deal with them, how to deal with the states and with the affected people. And in a context of strong opponents, this seems to make the voice of these actors weaker sometimes. I identify four groups of civil society actors acting as hubs for the mining debate. These are not the, we do not have only these actors, but I observe some four hubs. And these actors have some variation in their main environmental discourses. I consider here both in NGOs and social movements. The first, ANDA, works with a mix of conservationist and ecological modernization discourse. They don't consider mining as the main environmental problem of Minas Gerais. It's an actor with easy access to the media and was known as radical until the early 90s, but since the 20s, the 2000s, they have followed a more conceptualist approach, including providing environmental service to polluting companies, and they are recognized as interlocutor of mining companies in civil society. It can be considered isolated from other groups. The second group, Manuel Zon Project, works with a sustainable development discourse mainly. They have a strong action in river-based governance and grassroots actions with riverside communities. From the end of 2000s, with the growth of environmental problems linked to mining activities, they began to act with a more critical speech against the activity, getting closer to groups with more radical postures, such as Movisan. They are also an actor with easy access to the media and had close ties with the state government some years ago. The third group is the Movisan, with an environmental justice discourse, can be described as a cluster of a lot of different movements and activists. It had successful strong actions to ban mining or in important places. They have strong performances in the State Council of Water Resources and in the State Council of Environment, always acting against mining companies. And the fourth group is what I call the hegemonic left environmentalists, MABI and MAM. These two social movements are linked to Via Campesina, and they are close to left-wing political parties. MABI began to act on the mining agenda after the rupture of the Samarco tailing dam, and became one of the main interlocutors of those affected by this disaster. And MAN started working in Minas Gerais in some process of resistance to mining outside the central region of the state, where groups like linked to Movsan are not so present. Both MAB and MAN are very close to the state public prosecutor's office and develop technical advisory actions in the communities affected by the two tail dance disasters. They have a strong, great capacity to mobilize people in demonstrations and other public events, but they were criticized by other groups for not being present in debates like the simplifying of the environmental license process that occurred during the Workers' Party government in Minas Gerais. And they are also criticized for trying to control the debate, to create some kind of hegemony of the debate sometimes. Just before going to the next step, it's important to stress that the connection between some groups, especially the ones around Movisan and Manuelzão hubs, become stronger after the last Telidan disaster, with the creation of a crisis committee of civil society actors. Now I'm going to change to another point. So the second issue is the news media, and the constraint to public debate is the political economy of the news media. We know the news media are both deliberative actors and deliberative arenas, and that they are potential connectors of deliberative systems. But they are also companies in many contexts. And this business dimension of the news media, especially in places where the presence of public media system, is weak or does not exist, seems to deserve more attention. The material condition of existence of these news groups are very important for democracy and cannot be treated secondarily. So the journalists interviewed for this research stressed that a bargain relationship was established between the press and the advertisers, the press and the mining companies. And this minimized the discussion of the problems about mining in the three main newspapers of Minas Gerais in that time. In this bargain relationship, journalist companies publish some critical articles on the subject. So sometimes they publish critical content about mining. But in the sequence, the mining companies buy series of advertisement in the press, what is transformed in a long period of silence about the environmental and social problems that involve the expansion of mining. If the mining companies stop doing the advertisements, there is a window of opportunities to critical content to be published, but this window tends to be closed fast. So the journalists often now know part of the mining problems involving mine activity, but most of the time cannot get their suggestions for news articles accepted by editors. Civil society actors inform journalists of many of the violations of rights and risks to ecosystems. However, the news media refusal to produce content on the issue has weakened the ties between journalists and civil society. There is a loss of trust from civil society organizations to the news media. Next point is the state. The idea here is to understand how the state receives demands, receives claims, claims about mining from civil society and other actors, mainly observing arenas in the legislative, executive, and judicial system that could process these demands, and sometimes they do it. I focus in one space in the executive branch, the State Environment Council, in the State Legislative Assembly, and in the State Public Prosecutor's Office as a whole. They are institutions which could receive demands, which could receive claims and increase the debate, and sometimes they start it. The Legislative Assembly has public hearings and special participatory commissions, for example, prosecutors can amplify the demands of civil society to other actors in the state, and the State Environmental Council would be the institutional arena where civil society actors, the state and market actors deliberate about norms and the possibility of open or expansion of new mines. But very often, it does not occur, or the evaluation of the claims in these institutions have been stopped or neglected. So the factor one is the ambivalent role of the State Public Prosecutor's Office. The Public Prosecutor's Office can act as an amplifier of the claims made by citizens and civil society actors, establishing a connection between issues observed or experienced by these actors and other state actors, as I said. So in some cases of mining conflicts, the Public Prosecutor's Office, after interactions with civil society actors, asked the executive branch to act in a way to solve some problems involved in the activity. But the organ has also developed actions to construct agreements between companies that violate rights or commit environmental infractions and affected communities. In the evaluation of other researchers on mining activity in Minas Gerais, through these consensualist actions, mainly but not only through the terms of adjustment of conduct, the Public Prosecutor's Office often ends up negotiating rights. These instruments turn out to be interesting for the companies because in many cases they gain time to manage or to postpone the application of the agreements or got less severe punishment for their failures and faults. These instruments also transfer the conflict from the public sphere and from public spaces to arenas controlled by the Public Prosecutor's Office. What can give sometimes can give privileged conditions for companies to operate. The second factor is the state that constrains the deliberation about mining is the distorted institutional design of the State Environmental Council, known as COPAN. Almost all large enterprises, like the expansion or opening of mines, as well as changes in some environmental norms, need to be evaluated by the COPAN or technical chambers connected to it. The COPAN composition has always been marked by some accommodation between the interests of mining companies and the state government. And there is some kind of automatic alignment of the state representatives to the market representatives in the institution, in this arena. And most of the time, part of the actors who are elected as civil society members have direct connection with market ones, as being members of engineers association, for example. this contributes to make the discursive representation of Copan distorted. What is unfolded in votes, deliberations, and decisions approved in the arena. The third factor tries to understand the constraints in the Legislative Assembly and is related to campaign funding for politicians and lobbying. This is something that I still need to develop further. So the Legislative Assembly has a strong participative space, public hearings, special committees, commissions, and other instruments as popular initiative bills, which sometimes are involved in some discussions about mining. But these discussions almost never go on. The mining companies were among the largest founders of electoral campaigns in Brazil until 2015, when donations by private actors were suspended. And it's not necessary to consider how this model creates discursive shortcuts that facilitate the access of lobbyists and groups linked to mining companies to both the executive and legislative branches, implying decisions that are not justified and publicly debated. And thinking, and I need to think how this can block the development of debates in the legislative house. And now the time control problems. Sorry. So the final dimension considered to understand the constraints to the public debate involves the time control issue. This issue is connected to interactions that occur among actors and institutions in the state and the public sphere. The main point here is that citizens, the different actors and institutions can deal with time in different ways, different times, different time dimensions, interfere in the way these actors understand and interact with discursive demands and other political processes. And the development of political process can be time controlled by different actors involved in them, starting, stopping, or giving different rhythms to discursive flows. The time control of the political process can facilitate or constrain, delay, or make impossible the possibilities of argumentative exchange, making possible the participation of actors and the decision making. I try to identify a set of four temporal dimensions, and the rational, the cyclical, the subjective, and the rhythmic. And it's necessary to ponder that these dimensions do not operate in isolated. Sometimes they overlap each other. So the first is the duration dimension. The state time, can say. The duration dimension of time governs a series of standards, procedures, and processes that make the liberal state work. It concerns linear and scheduled time based on patterns of hours, days, and years. As detailed by the researcher Elizabeth Coyne, this time demarcation patterns are invisible boundaries that determine the insertion or exclusion of people and things in certain political orders. And this makes the duration dimension always present in the deliberative process, besides a marker of beginning and end of deliberations. a common relationship between deliberation and this duration of time concerns the assessment that a certain amount of time is needed so that people involved in a given discursive process can appropriate the information that allows them to understand what is at stake, and a certain amount of time is needed in a way that people can exchange understandings on how to solve a given issue together. And there is an epistemic issue here. It's almost common in deliberative theory and practice to say that it takes time to deliberate well and reach the best decisions. But here there is also something that refers to the inclusion and fairness dimension of deliberative process. It takes a certain amount of time for all involved to know what is going on and to speak, to have voice, to be listened. The problem is that this durational dimension of time carries ambivalence. More time can lead to physical and psychological exhaustion, which can trigger disengagements, make it difficult to sustain the presence of bodies, the presence of citizens, and disadvantage discourses. The cyclical dimension. This is a logic of representing and understand time based on nature, culture, and religion. So planting and harvest cycles, seasons, and religious calendars alter the perception of time and dictate activities that must or must not be done at certain times, repeating themselves at the beginning or end of these cycles. In rural contexts, such as those observed among some of the affected by mining projects, this dimension is extremely present. And this is directly connected with the subjective dimension of time, the next that I will discuss. But this dimension also presents itself in certain processes of the liberal state, such as electoral cycles, whose beginnings and ends may interrupt the evaluation and discussion of certain bureaucratic and legal issues. And the subjective dimension of time, so it sits and carries unique perceptions and experience about time. This occurs even if shared contemporary process led to some common perceptions of how to experience the world, such as the perceptions of acceleration. All citizens have their different temporal perceptions marked by the way they are socialized, deal with technologies, develop professional activities, how they deal with nature. And this brings distinct implications for the way they experience the course of discursive process in which they are involved, such as environmental conflicts and expanded or small deliberation process. And this affects how people deal with waiting for state policies and state decisions too. And the rhythmic dimension of time, the last one. So this rhythmic dimension is very important to understand this work as a whole. It is connected to the attempts of different political actors to control the discursive process and the power of each one of them, the power of each of these actors, and how can they use this power to control the process. being able to accelerate, to stop or suspend discursive process is as important as presenting convincing arguments. That's the point. State, market, and civil society actors get involved in controlling the pace of political process. So a street demonstration, for example, or important newspaper interview, or judicial process, all of them are capable to start or suspend discursive process, for example. And the actors can use these repertories of action, they can use different strategies to make things accelerate, stop, restart, and so on. And the rhythm, this rhythmic dimension also tells of the contingency and articulations of the political process along the lines of what Laclau and Murphy placed. So temporal ruptures, events, accelerations, and prolongations can lead to the creation or to the end of new groups, new forms of understanding the problems, and new ways of framing a certain issue. So the point is that not only through speech and the silence that the debate is started or stopped. It's not just about the presence of arenas and how they are designed. Giving time and stopping time, controlling hitting are also fundamental for understanding discursive and deliberative process. So to conclude, the work focuses on four issues that we believe help to understand the constraints to the public debate on mining, civil society organization, gaps in space for receiving demands from the state, the political economy of the media, and the dispute for control of the time of conflicts of political process. It draws attention to how the low coordination, the low cooperation between civil society actors, even in a context of a diversity of actors, can hinder the construction of strong argumentative line when faced with very strong opponents. And calls for the need to deepen the understanding of this political economy of the news media and how it affects deliberation. And calls attention for the need to think about time as an axis that complements the understanding of deliberative discursive process together to the study of actors, arenas, and discourses. That's it.
Yes, great.